Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
At this time, I'm gonna call the meeting to order, please. Let us bow for our invocation, please. Our Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for this opportunity to serve Alamance County. And we thank you for the citizens, Lord, that are here tonight. We thank you for their input into this. And we pray, Lord, that we make the right decisions as we go about our business. And Lord, we do so pray for our reevaluation process, and it has been a tough one. And Lord, we thank you for everything that you do for us. And just lead us and guide us, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, do I have any public comments? Wonderful. Something's wrong.
Prayers have already been answered.
I didn't pray for that, too.
Quick, too.
Oh, thank you. At this time, is Mr. McCarthy here from R&M Appraisal? We did invite them to ask questions of them. When we talked with Ms. Horton, she suggested that we invite them and ask them questions, but evidently they're not here. So at this time, I'm going to call on Mr. Albright to, just for the record, to read the questions that we had for them. So you will know that we did have these questions ready for them, and they have not shown up. Craig, have you heard anything at all?
No, ma'am. We did receive written response back and a fax response back, but at this time they chose not to attend.
Okay. So I'm going to turn this over to Mr. Albright.
All right. If I may just sit here and read them.
I have no problem. As long as I can hear you, Albright.
All right. The main question the board had for Mr. McCarthy was to ask him to explain the difference in the contract base amount of $275,000 versus the actual payment that was billed by his company of $581,577. We also had some questions about certain personnel and their qualifications to do some of the work for him. We had questions about the documentation about the number of hours actually worked by these folks. If county vehicles were used and how often they were used. There are many unanswered questions about the contract, some of which I don't want to get into right now because I would rather have the element of having him hear them come from me first rather than through a recording. But some of the main things we're concerned about in reviewing the contract is the fact that some of the base contract items that were contracted for, that we thought we were paying for in the base contract, were actually billed as additional items. And so that is some cause for concern. Some of the reappraisal assistance actually started being billed in August of 2007, when the reappraisal had just started. So those type of questions and the fact that Mr. McCarthy's not here is disturbing. A little disconcerting. We got a letter from his attorney saying he would not be here tonight. So I hope that his attorney will call us and make an appointment and come and see us. But as I said before, the major problem I have with it is that we were billed almost twice, well, actually more than twice, the base amount. And that began before the appraisal was complete, before the schedule of values was complete. So these types of questions need to be answered. There may be a logical explanation for it. I'd like to hear it. And I'd like to give an additional report to the board at that time.
Is that all you have? Okay. And we would all like to know that, by the way, all the commissioners.
My understanding from an email that I got, or at least a phone call that I made after I got the email, that somebody had said from his area that he wanted to meet with y'all privately. I know I heard that.
That is what he would like to do. We will try to set that meeting up. We got the facts late Friday and the hard copy of the letter today, and we haven't had the opportunity. We wanted to first see if he was going to come today to make sure, but then we'll try to set that up tomorrow.
Well, I don't think I want to meet privately. I mean, I think it should be an open meeting with them, and is that not one thing we discussed, and they don't want to do that?
I don't think that they're willing to have. I think there's some proprietary information they're worried about that we're not sure what that could be.
He is an employee of this board. This board hired him, and he should come and answer questions. They're spending the taxpayers' money and quite a bit of it, and we felt like it'd be appropriate for him to do it
in public. Yeah, in public. Yeah, we did say that.
So. Well, are we going to hold to that? Right.
Yeah.
We can. I don't know if they're coming or would come if decided if we put that line in the sand that we asked them to come. I'm not sure if they would come or not, is the question.
What would be our alternative?
We've already paid them.
We're holding payment at this point until some of these issues can be resolved.
And how much is outstanding on that?
Last payment is about $13,000. So we are holding payment on that.
Question.
Yes, ma'am.
Would the sheriff like to make a road trip and bring him here? Just a question.
Any other comments from you all?
But okay. If we can get a meeting with the county attorney and myself, do you want us to go ahead and try to resolve some of these things? Because, again, if he refuses to come, I want to make sure we're going the direction you want us to.
Well, we can send him the questions if he refuses to come, but and see what he does as far as sending him our questions that we have, I guess. How does the board feel about that? And just see if he answers them to our
we could
satisfaction.
We could ask him the questions in another forum, too, if he refuses to cooperate.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Judicial kind.
Right.
Right.
But, I'd like to see, I'd like to see some answers, and certainly we can report to the people.
Exactly. Because we are desperate for these answers ourselves, and this is what we've been really searching for.
If that's the direction, what we will do is we will send them a letter tomorrow with a list of the questions and ask that they respond back in writing to us, either in person or by writing at our next meeting.
Is that agreeable?
Sounds good.
Okay.
There's a consensus here?
Yeah.
Okay, Mr. Albright, y'all do that for us?
We'll do it.
Thank you.
Okay. The next is Dr. Patrick Harmon of Hayden Harmon, and I will let Mr. Harmon come forward. How are you tonight? Oh, he's got money for us, hey.
Well, I got real money and fake money. My wife only lets me have so much money.
Oh, okay.
So for my props, I have to bring fake money. I can donate my real money if you like.
Now, wait a minute.
I have a problem with that.
The $1 bills. That's real money.
This is real money? This is bone. Got a few cool dollars. I'd like to thank the commissioners for giving me the chance to spend a few minutes to talk about the Public Transit Task Force, and that's why I'm here tonight. I'm not really here for the foundation. It's kind of my day job. But one of the things I've been involved with for the past 15 months or so is the Community Council Public Transit Task Force. And that got started back in March of 2008. The Community Council, the United Way coordinates the Community Council, and that's where the social service folks meet every month and talk about different issues. And public transportation was always coming up, and so we decided we'd try to do something about it and got together this task force. And there was about 20-some people that are fairly active in it, from the community college, the university, Women's Resource Center, Family Abuse Services, Healthy Alamance, ACTA, United Way, those kinds of folks. And so we had two basic goals with the work of the task force. The first was to get public support behind public transit in the county. And the second thing was to educate ourselves and our local officials about how to do a public transit system, because it's a fairly complicated endeavor. And so our activities have been centered around that. And we're basically sort of just wrapping up now with our work. And one of the things we did was to go out and talk to community groups about public transit and what's involved with it and how much it costs and how it could work and all that sort of stuff. So we've talked about 20 groups so far. You know, your Rotary clubs, your Civitan clubs, and all that sort of thing. And so we've done a lot of that. We've talked to various city councils. We've talked to five so far in the county about public transit. So we've gotten a lot of attention that way. And then the big activities we did with our local officials, there are three of them. The first one was last July. We had a public transit forum, and we had a gentleman from URS, which does transportation stuff, talk about the Piedmont Seamless Tried Mobility Study. That's quite a mouthful. But that was looking at integrating the various transportation systems in this kind of a coherent system where if you're a rider, you can sort of get into it. And who's actually running the buses is irrelevant to you because you're getting from point A to point B. So that was a study with the Piedmont Area Regional Transportation at all those issues. So we talked about their findings. And then we had Scott Ryan from the Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation, the park and ride folks, come and talk, explain kind of what they did in the Piedmont. And so that was fairly well attended. We had about 30 people, including business folks and local officials. And so that was pretty good. And then in August, we did two site visits to smaller urban areas that have public transit systems. So we could sort of learn about how they came up with their transportation system and how they funded it and marketed it and all that sort of stuff. So we did those two in August, to Hickory and Wilson. And we had, I guess, another 25 people go on that to learn about that. And, of course, we took them on a bus, of course. We had to do that. So those are the three big things that we did with our local officials to learn about public transit. And then one of the things we've learned in doing all this was that it's kind of complicated. I mean, it's in one way, people sort of get buses. You get on them and you go somewhere. But as far as how that all, the operational details, how you fund it, who's going to be in charge of it, it's fairly complex. And so as a board, an elected board, you really can't vote on anything because it's too big and there's too many details to be hashed out before you can say, let's do it or let's don't do it. And so what happened is the Hayden Harmon Foundation funded this implementation plan that's going on now. And there was a kickoff meeting in October with a lot of you local officials came to that, as well as some business folks. And there's been a steering committee meeting every month or so to hash out this detailed plan. And Mr. Engel has been on the steering committee for that, as well as representatives from Burlington, Graham, Gibsonville, and a couple of business folks. And that's just about to wrap up. And what they've come up with is kind of a three-phase plan for getting public transportation in the county. And when it's finally finalized, I'll get the gentleman, Kurt, to come explain it all. But basically, the first phase will be park and ride service. There's a couple reasons for that. It's mainly it's a lot easier to do. PART has been doing this with a lot of different communities, Mount Airy and Randolph County and Asheboro. So they've been doing it with a lot of folks, and they have this process in place. So it's a lot easier to say, let's do it. And they know how to do the park and ride lots and hire the drivers and get the buses and all that sort of stuff. So it's a pretty easy first step. And there are a lot of commuters in and out of Alamance County. There's about 20,000. There's about 10,000 coming in and about 11,000 going out of the county both ways to work. So there's a lot of us driving around the road, and that includes me. I live in Greensboro, so I'm driving to Burlington every day, which gets kind of old after a while if you do it for 7 years that I've been doing it. So I have a bit of a personal example about sort of the savings you can get from public transit. I have a 62-mile round-trip commute, and AAA says it's 37 cents a mile to operate your car. And that doesn't count your loan payment if you're actually paying on your car. That's just to operate it and depreciation and all that sort of stuff. That's $23 a day that I'm taking to drive to Burlington and back. Now for PART, you can take it $2, you can go one way on a trip. So that's $4 a day, right? So basically I can save $19 a day taking the park and ride bus. So that adds it pretty quickly. That's where the fake money comes in. That's about $400 a month, right? That's about $5,000 a year to take the park and ride bus. That's a pretty good savings for commuters, right? And so that's a kind of a personal example about the benefits of public transit. It didn't take too long to make your money back. And so that's like the phase one. And, of course, these park and ride lots are near the interstate. And so unless you happen to work near the interstate or, say, the hospital, you have to have a way to get to work. And that's why this phase two is a feeder service type operation that gets people to work and then back out to the park and ride buses later on. And then the third phase is a fixed route system, which is your dedicated routes going between the cities. So that's kind of this three-phase plan that's being formulated in this implementation plan that should be finished in a couple of weeks. And so going back to the park and ride, you guys had a joint meeting with the city of Burlington about how to fund this thing, because that's always a kicker in this thing, is, you know, how are we going to fund it? Although Park can actually do it a few years without a local match. But there was discussion of this dollar tag fee as a way to become part of this park and ride service. And I do have an example, because I did some calculations. If you use that 37 cents a mile and figure you go from here to the Four Seasons Mall and back, it costs you about $19.50 to do that. Or you can take the park bus for $4, so you save 15 bucks. So if you actually take the park and ride bus one time every 15 years and you paid yourself back. So it doesn't take a whole lot of riding public transit to actually make your money back from your taxes. Another way to think about it is if you need to earn $2 more an hour if you live in Burlington but you want to work in Greensboro, so versus driving versus taking the park and ride bus, that's $2 an hour difference that you have to make to actually make more money. If it's $1.50, you're actually losing money to drive in Greensboro. So that's the park and ride part, and then the other parts get a little more complicated. That's why I get Kurt, the guy who's doing the study, to come back and talk to you guys about that. So that's kind of where we're at with this implementation plan. And one of the last things the task force has done is to get people to sign a petition in support of public transit, and I have that here, and I'll just read it real quick. It's to all the governing councils within Alamance County, including you guys, of course. We, the undersigned petitioners, support the recent efforts of our local officials to learn about and discuss the development of a public transportation system within Alamance County. We, the undersigned petitioners, support the efforts of the Burlington City Council and Alamance County Commissioners to partner with the Piedmont Authority for Regional Transportation to develop a park and ride service for Alamance County. We, the undersigned petitioners, request our local governing council support the development of a fixed route service within Alamance County through capital investment, collaboration among municipalities, grant funds, and dedicated revenues. We, the undersigned, believe a fixed route service would be of the greatest benefit for us and our neighbors. A fixed route service would allow us and our neighbors to access services, commute to work, maintain our independence, and meet everyday household needs while saving money. We, the undersigned petitioners, commit to using a fixed route service when implemented in Alamance County. And we have 969 signatures so far.
If you
want to
start
with Mr. I just have the one copy.
Okay. Would you guys like to see them?
Thank you all.
Okay.
I mean, there's the handwritten, and then we entered.
Do you have any figures, basically, about the money that we might get from Burlington at this point, or right, from Park at this point?
Right. What happened at the Transportation Advisory Committee meeting, which meets every 3 or 4 months to talk about transportation issues just in general, and Mr. Boswell is on that committee. What is happening for this year is the city of Burlington, well, there's two things. There's the stimulus money, there's some being allocated for park and ride service, and that's 100% match. There's no local match required. And so Burlington's assigning that to Park, basically, to start this process of buying the land and developing the lots. And then every year, Burlington's eligible for public transit money as part of the gas tax, and it's about $1 million. And that part requires a local match, which is where the holdup is. But this year, Park has agreed to pay the local match, and they're using that $1 million to acquire some buses and further the development of the park and ride lots. So they're out sort of doing that right now. And so in a sense, we're going to have park and ride for a couple of years. I think parts of they can do it 3 years without a local match.
Without a local match.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, that's something that everybody needed to hear.
Right. Yeah.
Thank you, Pam.
Right. So. But if you start the dollar now, you can accumulate that money over several years.
Pam, I think you're looking at what, three parking ride lots?
Right, yeah, one in sort of, you know, both ends of the county and one kind of central. And there's, the foundation has a lot actually off Hatchery Road, and they're looking at that one. That's a dollar a year lease, so that'd be a lot cheaper because they're finding out land's still expensive.
Very.
particularly our commercial realtors, they've been calling me. But those lots, you know, right in the interstate are always valuable in any kind of economic climate. So, and they actually are getting some air quality money, and they might actually do one in Gibsonville. Because that has to
be in Guilford.
It's got to be in Guilford County. One of the two. So because of attainment issues or some bureaucratic reason, but Gibsonville is part of us, though.
We understand.
So, I mean, that's kind of,
it still could be a benefit over there.
Right. Oh, yes, yeah. Definitely. So, I mean, that's kind of where that stands. Okay.
Can I ask you a question?
Sure. I was going to ask that.
A security. I've had quite a few people inquire about the security for this park and ride, especially right. For the ladies.
Right. Well, I mean, the way Park develops them, and there's plenty of lighting, and there's patrolling and that sort of thing. And that's one of the ways that local folks have done the match is is to provide patrolmen coming by periodically and all that sort of stuff. I mean, as far as I know, they haven't had any trouble with there being any kind of vandalism or any kind of criminal activity. So. But that's another reason why you don't want it. It's kind of a remote place. If it's right on the interstate, it's fairly wide open. I mean, you can actually see, a lot of people be going by to see if something's amiss. So. And if you have it in a kind of obscure area, then people might get worried about somebody vandalizing a car, for example.
Any other questions?
No.
Anybody? Tim?
Appreciate it.
Thank you, Dr. Harmon.
Did you want my money?
Yeah.
And you can leave that.
Green, just leave
that. Well, we actually can't take it, but
30 years of parking right.
Thank you.
At this time, I would like to recognize Mac Williams, our president of the Alamance County Area Chamber of Commerce, to talk to us about the MSA resolution.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Commissioners, my name is Mac Williams. I'm president of the Alamance County Chamber, and I'm here tonight to discuss an issue about the Metropolitan Statistical Area and the recombination of the Alamance County Burlington MSA back with the Greensboro and Winston MSAs into what was formerly a larger MSA. I'm hopeful that you folks have a summary of the issue that I provided along with a copy of a resolution that the Chamber Board has already passed and submitted to the Office of Federal Management and Budget.
We don't have
it. We just have the resolution.
You just got the resolution? Okay.
I'm familiar with it because I came to the meeting.
Yes, you were there.
The other commissioners are not. If you could explain that a little bit.
For their benefit and for the benefit of those at home, and I hope I don't put all of you to sleep.
Kind of consolidated.
As you all know, the census is coming up, and the agency responsible for managing the census, the administration of the census, is the Office of Management and Budget at the federal in Washington, D.C. at the federal level. And every census, they try to set out rules and standards for a myriad of things affecting how the budget information will be disseminated. And how it's disseminated has a large impact on how it's used and how the people access it and use it. And so the rules and the standards are important for setting up what the end product is going to look like and what you and I and many, many others who make big decisions and little decisions, how they use the census data. And one of those is how the geographic units known as metropolitan statistical areas are put together. In the last census, the rules and standards that the OMB put together had an 8-county area of the Piedmont Triad as one big single MSA of a million-plus population. And with that ranking, the Greensboro Winston-Salem High Point, that's the title of it, that MSA was ranked about 34th in the country in terms of its size. In the last census, the OMB, in their wisdom, split up that 8-county MSA into 5 smaller areas, 3 MSAs and 2 what are called even smaller micropolitan areas. So we went from one big MSA of over a million people to 5 smaller areas. And our MSA, the good thing, I guess, if you will, Alamance County became its own single standalone MSA. Greensboro and some counties became an MSA, and Winston-Salem and some counties around it became an MSA. But none of us are in the top 50. In fact, none of us are in the top 70. And then the 2 smaller areas are even not even on the MSA radar screen at all. And that had 2 effects. And I'm speaking from the economic development point of view, which is, as you know, what the Chamber, that's one of the pieces of the mission that the Chamber has, is to promote economic development. And one of the, it's not a law anywhere or a mandate, but there's just kind of a general operating condition that if you're in the top 50 MSA, that's better than not being in a top 50 MSA. And the OMB's standards went basically balkanized the Piedmont Triad from one big MSA that was in the top, that was well in the top 50, to an MSA where nobody is in the top 50. And so we think that not being in the top 50 MSAs has a detrimental effect on our competitive advantages in the economic development world. Site selection consultants, retail people, and others use top 50 MSA as kind of a filter, a paper cut measurement, if you will. And so we think not being in the top 50 MSAs is detrimental in that regard. Secondly, we felt like the being in the smaller MSA has a very real potential detrimental effect on our hospital system. As you know, the hospital system, a major source of its funding is from the reimbursements for, I believe it's Medicare. Anyway, based on the MSA that they're in, their Medicare reimbursement rate is set at one level. And the MSA, if they're part of a larger MSA, it's at a higher level of reimbursement than if they're at a single lower MSA, which is set at a lower reimbursement. Well, when the OMB made their decision to go from one big MSA to three smaller ones, it threatened the hospital's funding source. They were able to avert that challenge by virtue of a technical provision that OMB allowed to allow them to merge with, at least for that purpose, with a larger area and keep their reimbursement level at a competitive number. So we think, too, that a second reason for advocating for a reconsolidation is that for the long-term interest of hospital funding, we think, and the hospital does too, that it's in their longer-term best interest not to depend on a technical provision by a federal agency from census to census, but rather to be inherently embedded in a larger MSA that has the reimbursement levels that they depend on for their finances. And so for those two reasons alone, there may be other reasons why reconsolidation is a good idea, but those are the two reasons that our chamber board considers it noteworthy to try to advocate for this. Now, I'm saying we're advocating for it. Office and Federal, the OMB office has taken comment from areas about rules and standards of one kind or another, and others from this region have already provided comment advocating for this reconsolidation into a bigger single MSA. What they do with all this comment, we may not know for another 2 or 3 years, as they factor all this in. All we can do is make a comment. Our taking action should not be I'm not going to hold out there that it's going to make the difference, and they're going to succumb because we said we wanted it the other way. It doesn't work that way. It's a federal issue. When OMB considers making a change to their rules and standards, they apply that change nationally and see how, and they try to look at how some change is going to affect the national scope, and they try to make their decisions based on that. All we can do at this point is to take a position to try to advocate for a change that we think will be in our long-term best interest and hope for the best. There's no guarantee that anything will happen. But I can guarantee that if we don't do something, it's not going to, yeah, right. So at least we're trying to do something proactive on our own behalf and hope for the best. And so the Chamber Board passed the resolution that you have in front of you. There's a second issue I want to address, and that resolution addresses it as well, as about the titling of the MSA or what people call it. The last time we were a large single MSA, it was the Greensboro Winston-Salem High Point MSA. And the reason is because these standards and rules that OMB picked, the rule was that they would pick the top population centers in the area, and that would be the title. And so it went. And so Burlington was not able to be named in the thing. And there was, at that time, some idea that that would enhance our visibility as a location by having our name in the title. And there was much ado and ruckus that arose about that. But nevertheless, that was the rule. Now, in the fractured scenario that our MSA is in, we do enjoy our own name, but it's on the MSA that's number 262 out of about 310. So what does that get us? And so we are saying that, the second part of our resolution says that we are advocating in the titling issue that rather than going for the names in the, of the larger population centers as they did the other time, now that they would be recombining three standalone MSAs, and ours is the name on one of those three, that instead of taking the population center names, they take the names of the population of the MSAs being reconsolidated. So that would be Greensboro, Winston-Salem, and Burlington. We would hope they would consider that as our comment for that aspect. But our resolution says that the titling issue is secondary to us to the issue of being reconsolidated back into a top 50 MSA. That's the more important one because there's more at stake at that. I think the name and the title may have some impact, but as a marketing aspect, most people that use the data tend to go with the first name of the MSA, and the others are secondary, usually in the user's mind, on how they use it and refer to it. So those are the three main points. Again, number one, we think we can be a more competitive arena if we're in a top 50 MSA. Number two, we think the hospital will be better served in the long run to be inherently embedded in an MSA whose cost of living indexes are such that the hospital's funding source isn't threatened. Number two, we think the titling issue is secondary to the other two I just mentioned, and I would ask for your consideration and support of the resolution. Here's what we will do with it once you act, and hopefully you will act in support of this. The time for the official comment to OMB has passed. The chamber got its message in prior to the April 13th issue, and for lots of reasons, there wasn't time for you all to get that message in, but I think the time is still there for us to effectively pass our support of this effort on to those in Washington who represent us, and maybe through the good graces of their offices, they can make comments to OMB on our behalf. So I think we still have time for that, and that is why I'm coming to you now. I'm going to Graham tomorrow night. I'm on the council agenda for Burlington in June. To try to get some of this public sector support. I think it'll be easier for our representatives in Washington to do our bidding if there's formal action to that effect from not just us at the chamber level, but from you all at the public sector level. So, again, I apologize to you all for this, for that, to the viewing audience who may be saying, what is he talking about? To talk about this, and I'll be happy to answer any questions.
And the airport benefit from this, just as the hospital would, maybe not on Medicaid, but with federal money, or
I don't think so. Mr. Danieli has been somewhat around these conversations. He's not mentioned that there's a direct connection on MSA ranking and airport funding, so I don't think so. But to be fair, on both the plus side and the minus side, I have to admit that I'm not exactly sure of all the ramifications, plus or minus, for this that may be out there. But I am going by a lot of conversations I've had with others who are more in tune with this. I've talked to some folks who are in OMB and tried to figure out exactly how this works. And they said that's the conundrum that you're in, is you have to act and make a position, and then you may not know for some extracted period what we're going to do. All you can do is make your comment and hope that what you want actually ends up working out.
Does it have any bearing on how the state puts us in districts for incentives?
No.
Or the three levels of, you know what I'm talking about?
Yeah, I do, but that's a state issue.
So they wouldn't have any relationship.
There's no correlation between your MSA standing and what the state decides to do on how they divvy up the state for those programs. Those are completely state programs.
Mac, it's actually about companies that are looking to relocate or to come into, a lot of it is it not?
From our point of view, that's what we think happens. It's hard to prove a negative. In other words, what have we lost because we weren't a top 50? Well, I don't know, because we never saw them or talked to them.
Right.
It's a very difficult thing to prove. But we have talked, me and my colleagues have talked to site selection consultants and others who say that, from time to time, an easy cut for a company to make, especially one who isn't used to more rural and spread out. North Carolina's kind of a spread out state. We have our distribution, our population fairly distributed among towns of our size plus urban areas. But folks who don't know North Carolina or small towns, you know, they have images of the quality of life that may be attendant with smaller places. And so sometimes for many site selections, it's just an easy thing to do to make as a paper cut or an early filter a top 50 MSA. That way they know they're going to have access to airports and indoor plumbing and things of that nature.
At this time, I'll entertain a motion that we support or the reconsolidation of the Greensboro.
Okay.
Motion and second. All in favor?
Well, thank you for your leadership. We'll go with Graham tonight and Burlington in June and ask them for same consideration. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Matt. The next one here is the Children's Mental Health Awareness Day proclamation. Mr. Gary Ander, Project Director of Elements Alliance for Children and Families. Hey, Mr. Ander, how are you?
As many of you might know, I've been working along with a number of organizations in the county and with the county commissioners on developing system of cares for children and youth in Alamance County who have multiple needs from multiple child-serving systems. Commissioner Engel has been sitting on our Children's Executive Oversight Committee. Commissioner Sutton has been sitting on the Juvenile Crime Prevention Council Committee. Commissioner Vaughn is sitting on the Social Services Board. So I think you know a lot about the work that we're trying to do to implement these systems for children. Interestingly enough, over the last 4.5 years, we've realized that although we've been working with school-age children, we've been missing a major opportunity to work with very young children and their families from birth to 5. And recognizing that we could actually divert probably a number of longer-term behavioral, psychological problems if we could actually intervene earlier with early identification. So about 2 years ago, we applied for a grant from the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration, otherwise known as SAMHSA, to develop a sustainable infrastructure that develops and implements a continuum of services and supports for children 0 to 5 and their families. And these children who have serious emotional or social concerns. And we haven't done this in a vacuum. We're working with some pretty significant partners. The Alamance Partnership for Children, the Alamance County Health Department, the Alamance Caswell Rockingham LME, Alamance Burlington School System, the Duke Center for Child and Family Policy, the Duke Center for Child and Family Health, and the National Center on Child Traumatic Stress. Our goals with this grant are multifaceted, but long-term outcomes is we want to reduce child abuse and neglect in Alamance County. We want to reduce the number of foster care placements. We want to improve school readiness and school success. and we want to increase parental competence to intervene appropriately with their children. Part of our mission with this SAMHSA grant, with the Alamance Alliance for Children and Families, is creating awareness of these issues in Alamance County and educating the community that early intervention exists and can have substantial impact on child development and later adult development. So with that in mind, I'd like to read a proclamation for Children's Mental Health Day that I hope that you will support. Whereas strong mental health is essential for young children to be healthy and ready for school. Whereas in 2007, Alamance County Department of Social Services investigated 1,729 reports of child abuse and neglect involving 1,306 children under the age of six. Of these reports, 15%, or 197, were in need of services or substantiated for abuse or neglect. And whereas a substantial portion of abused and neglected children suffer with emotional and social distress, including post-traumatic stress disorder. And whereas 10 to 15% of developing preschoolers, estimated at 1,447 children in Alamance, have chronic, mild to moderate levels of behavioral problems. And whereas untreated behavioral problems may lead to many young children being removed from their homes and placed in foster care. And whereas it is important that children, along with their families and their communities, learn about the warning signs of mental health disorders and where to obtain necessary assistance and treatment. And whereas early diagnosis and appropriate treatment of mental health disorders among children provide them better opportunities to lead full and productive lives. And whereas the participation of family members in the assessment and treatment of children is integral to positive clinical outcomes. And whereas an awareness of the mental health services provided in Alamance County can lead to diagnosis and treatment of these mental health disorders. And whereas parents, teachers, guidance counselors, social workers, medical professionals, neighbors, friends, and concerned citizens recognize that there are many ways to reach out to the children of Alamance County that are in need of education, protection, and mental health resources. And whereas National Children's Mental Health Awareness Day provides an important opportunity for our community to show how children and youth with mental health needs, as well as their families, thrive when they have the right supports and services available, now and therefore, the Alamance Board of County Commissioners does hereby proclaim, I guess that's for you to proclaim, May 7th, 2009, Children's Mental Health Awareness Day in Alamance County.
Okay. Does anyone have any questions for Mr. Anderson? No. Comments?
So I'd like to hand you some ribbons that hopefully you will wear this week and throughout the month of May. Commemorating Children's Mental Health Day and Mental Health Awareness.
I'd like to make a comment. I worked in social services for 11 years, and I actually dealt with the foster parents. And I do know that the children, I've seen children come in that were battered, and small children thrown against the wall. This is a great thing, I think, that we have. And what I'd like to ask, do you have anything that's going on that day, or do you have any programs for that day anywhere?
We don't have any big programming going on this year. We do have some additional just awareness things going out. We do have posters going out. Because we're in the planning year of this grant, there are a lot of unknowns, so we don't know what the services are going to be exactly yet, and that's a community process that we'll be working on. Okay. October 1, we will be identifying the first children, and this year we hope to identify 100 children for prevention and intervention services.
I don't think that'll be hard to do either.
I don't think so much.
Unfortunately, I don't think that'll be
exactly
hard to do.
Exactly. Thank you, Commissioner. Thank you.
Where would you be getting the leads for these children? Where or how?
Many different areas, but daycare centers will be primary, pediatricians. We probably will get some from clergy. And so that's one of the reasons that we need to do a real large social marketing campaign, because there's not always an awareness that very young children can have social emotional concerns. And we have to actually have parents recognize what the symptoms of those are, what the manifestations are, so that they're aware and they can get information. And also allow the service providers to recognize that there are interventions so that they can make appropriate referrals.
Did you do any kind of study, or is that in the process, where we can reduce foster care for children that are in harm's way?
Well, I think that with this, if we can keep families together, I mean, as you're aware, when we're working with really young children, very young children, most of the work is with parents. And clearly, if we can keep families together, which is one of our goals, we'll dramatically decrease foster care placements.
We also have call-ins, too, from people. People that just call in and know that a child's being abused or whatever.
Exactly.
And they don't even have to give their name.
Right.
And a lot of people don't know that. They think they may become involved. But they don't even, if they know of a child, they need to call in to social services and make a referral, and then they will go out and check on it. So
that's correct.
People need to know that, too.
Thank you for doing this.
Okay. Do I hear
thank
a motion?
You. Thank you. And thank you for your support.
Do we need a motion for the proclamation, a general consensus?
I'll move.
Okay.
Second.
Have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. We will certainly do that.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you,
Mr. Andrews. Okay, the next thing that we have is community garden site, Mark Danley, horticultural extension agent. Hey, Mr. Danley, how are you?
Wonderful. Good evening. Good. So I am Mark Danley, a horticultural extension agent for Alamance County, and I want to talk to you briefly about community gardens. And there's a big interest now in people growing their own food, save some money on their food budget, and basically it's a place where people can have a plot of land, individual or a family, to grow their own food. And we want to go a little bit further than just giving them lots of land to garden. We want to do some education while they're in the garden. So with our Master Gardener volunteers, we want to help to teach them how to plant plants, how to take care of them, how to identify insects and diseases, how to control them if need be. And then further beyond that, once the crops start coming in, then we want to have Evelyn Deloach in our office, Glenda Lennon's health department, work with these families on nutrition and how to preserve, prepare these foods. So it's an educational thing as well as just an effort for people to grow their own food. And we've got a little handout there. There's an application to have a garden plot, some of the basic rules that we'll have for the garden, and then we've got the liability lease waiver that Mr. Albright has looked at for, so we're covered on that. And then there is a picture there of the site, and basically this is a piece of lawn that is on the south end of the Human Services Center. It's about 10,000 square feet there. We haven't attempted to draw in the plots yet. We've got to talk to Richard Hill and see what kind of access they need to the building, what kind of utilities there may be buried underground that we need to be mindful of. Pretty much there really is no cost, or very little cost, to the county. We will be using some water off of the building. Probably, if it doesn't rain at all, will cost us maybe $25 or $30 a month for the growing season, so a couple hundred dollars for the entire year, and we'll get donations from individuals and businesses for tools and water hoses and those kinds of supplies, things we need.
So this is for anybody in Alamance County?
Right. Pretty much any Alamance County citizen.
I planted tomatoes a couple years ago, and I had them at that far apart, and my neighbor came and told me I couldn't plant them that close together, and I had never planted a tomato.
We can teach you how.
So I did spread them out, and I had really good tomatoes.
I think it's a great idea.
Mm-hmm. It is good.
It is.
They help preserve the heritage.
Sure.
As far as knowing how to just plant things and grow things. And
yeah, a lot of folks don't know how anymore.
Yep.
Not everybody has a green thumb.
I'm sorry, what's the square footage of each plot?
We'll probably have about a 3 by 20, so about 60 square feet. So fairly small plots, but you can grow a lot of food in a small place like that. So mostly going to be tomatoes, peppers, squash. You wouldn't do corn. Things like that, you can get a lot of produce in a small area.
Are you going to do a raised bed, or is this going
to... Primarily, we'll probably just raise it a little bit, but we won't actually build any planters or anything.
Are you going to have guards to keep from stealing your stuff?
I'm not sure how to handle that.
I'm just checking.
Yeah. Hopefully it's visible enough from the road.
We can enhance the sheriff's department to check on it every now and then.
That's out of his jurisdiction.
Yeah, keep somebody from stealing our produce.
It's a problem.
Okay.
You have any questions?
Anybody got any questions?
No, but I think it's a great idea.
I think it's a really good idea. Yeah. We don't need to make any, you just want us aware of this, right?
Right, and your permission.
Yes, sir.
I don't have a problem. Does anybody have a problem? We don't need to vote out that. Just a general consensus.
Can we go by and pick up a tomato from time to time?
Yes. Off your own plot now, Ian. Anybody got any more questions? I think you have our consensus for
this. Yes,
thank you very much. Okay, the next thing we have is the facilities improvement plan update from Mr. Ken Burgess.
Madam Chair, members of the board, good evening. Mm-hmm. We can save that $25 a month if we don't fix the roof on the HSC building. We can pump the water off into the garden. Another story. The architect should be on their way if they're not making their way from the overflow room there. Once they get here, I'll get started on our update here. Be making their way here.
Oh, here they come.
We have Lucian Routon and Charles Nicholson, the architects on the project, so they'll be here to answer any questions. Plus, there's a couple of specific areas regarding the courthouse renovation that I want them to talk about in just a few minutes. So let me just go ahead and get started real quick. You have before you, and I laid you a copy. This is what was in your agenda pack, but I laid you a little larger version there that you might be able to see a little bit better. And it's Exhibit B. Not going to go read the whole thing, but do want to highlight some of the more important things. If you look in column B there on that spreadsheet, that gives you a list of all of the projects. I'm going to run through those very quickly and tell you the projects that we're planning on doing. We've talked about this on several occasions. Just kind of want to refresh everybody's memory on that. The important number is when you go over to column O, that is the current estimates of those projects, what they're going to cost. Those numbers are still, we're still tweaking those numbers. We won't have accurate numbers actually until we get the bids back in. And then at that point, we'll have accurate numbers as to what these projects are going to actually cost. But those are the most current estimates we have at the time. If you look in column B, HSC, Human Services Center, we're going to be doing some work there. That project is a little under $500,000. The Family Justice Center, which is the old DSS building on Martin Street, we're going to be renovating that. That building is a two-story, I don't know if you've seen it or not, but those that have maybe have seen it, it's a two-story facility. When you look at it at the front, you just see the top floor of it. The whole upstairs will be renovated for the Family Justice Center. There are two wings on the bottom that you can enter from the back, ground level on the back. If you're standing on Martin Street looking at the building, the wing on the left, Bylan, will be the fire marshal's office and the emergency operations center, so that will be renovated for them. The wing that is on the right bottom will actually be it's going to be basically an open room that will be used as a training center. We can have meetings, county meetings, training centers. It'll be shared between the county and the Family Justice Center. However, that is Family Justice Center area there. So as they need that space, they will be able to take over that bottom half of that as they need it. But we anticipate it'll be sometime down the road. So we'll be using that space jointly with them until they actually need to acquire it. And then we'll give that space up as needed. So that project is a little bit over $1.1 million. County office building, this building and the courtroom building beside us, we're doing some renovations to it. The maintenance building, most of that is site work out there with the drive and some other issues down there. Criminal courts building, which is the courthouse down to our left here, that building is being renovated. There is a lot of roofing projects that are going to be done. As you notice in the first section and the last section there's two different roofing bundles. What we found out is our original estimates that we had on those projects, it's about doubled since our original estimates. As they got more into the design phase and the inspection phase, they discovered that a lot of the roofs already had two layers of roofing on them. You cannot, by code, put a third layer of roofing on. So we've got to pull those old layers off before we put the new on, so that is added to the cost of that. We've also got some paving bundles. Those are actually repairing some existing parking lots and paving some parking lots now that are gravel parking lots or dirt parking lots, so that's what that includes. Item 4A and 4B is a generator for this building that we're currently in, and also the courthouse annex, which is right beside us. That will actually generate both of those buildings. Primarily the need for that is for CECOM downstairs and for MIS up on the third floor, so it will generate those. That project, at your last meeting, you approved the purchase of the generator. We'll be bidding out the service work for that, and we'll bring back that contract to you at some point in the future, and that will actually be paid. The generator itself was paid out of MIS's budget. The service work will actually be paid out of the 800 megahertz budget. So those, the other than the design work and engineering, will come out of the facility improvement plan, but the cost for the generator and services are actually coming out of other budgets. As you look down towards the next project is the courthouse budget, and I'll go into a little bit more detail about that in a few minutes. Cedar Rock and also Eli Whitney, which relates to Parks and Rec, those projects are being done. And then project number nine is several facilities that we're doing some repair work, some renovation work to, or some ADA work to. So, and y'all have these in some prior documents that have been given to y'all. And then, of course, finish out with the projects there as far as roofing and paving bundles. Now, as you look to the right, column O there, the total of estimate, at least at this point, for all of this work is $9,355,961. Now, what we have done is we have broken these into two groups. As you see, the top group is Group A projects, and the bottom group is Group B projects. If you look over to your far right column on that sheet, you'll see the estimated construction start date for those projects. Half of the projects, approximately half of the projects in dollar values, will start this calendar year. The other half will start sometime after the first of the year. So those are kind of how we're grouping those. That helps us from a budgetary standpoint, because the projects we do this year will actually only have to make a payment on half of our normal yearly payment on that. We'll have to make in next budget year. The projects that we start after January the 1st, we will not have to make any payments on that debt service in the next budget year coming up. So that's how that will work. We'll talk a little bit about the courthouse project. You got Exhibit C there that's attached to the back there. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the details of what's going to be done in the courthouse. Really, the biggest projects we got is really the Family Justice Center, Fire Marshal's facility there, the old DSS building and the courthouse building, and then your paving and roofing bundles. Those are really your largest projects. And if you look at the courthouse renovation, there's quite a bit that we're going to do there. We started out with a project that was somewhat over $4 million. Realize that we need to scale that back, but still be able to do a lot of repair work to that project, to the courthouse, because we needed to divert some of that money to probably some of the roofing projects. And then also we felt like that being able to reduce the size of the project for the courthouse was probably a wise thing to do. Basically, we're going in there. I don't know how many of y'all have been into the courthouse lately, but there is the courtroom up there is in not in real good shape. It's kind of it's an eyesore, to say the least. They're going to go in there and totally restore that room. There, if you can go in there, all of the windows in the courtroom except for one that we pulled off for testing purposes, but all the rooms have been covered up with sheetrock or some type of material. Those are going to be pulled off. The windows in there will be replaced. New curtains will be put up. They'll be painted in there. The roof, and as you can see, certain areas of that is dropping down. That will all be repaired. The HVAC system will be replaced. Carpet will be replaced. The seats will be replaced. There will be repair work done to the judge's bench and to the witness area, and also the clerk's area. So the total courtroom will be totally remodeled. And you can see the top half of Exhibit C lists all of the stuff that would be done related to the courthouse. The bottom half is the other areas that will be done. Courthouse, we're going to have to put a handicap ramp on the outside. All of the windows throughout the whole building will be replaced, and I'm going to get the architects to talk about that in just a minute, the need to replace those versus refurbishing the ones that are in there. The building will be dried in. There's some water issues down in the basement, but then there's also some water issue up on the upper floors also. So we've got some significant water issues. So all of that will be taken care of. And then there's some other rooms that will be repaired and all of that. So it will be a nice project. It will give the building inside a different look, at least on the courtroom level and on some of the adjacent rooms off of the courtroom. There will be some work done in the basement in addition to the waterproofing. One of the rooms down there is currently used as a hearing room for the clerk of courts. That's going to be remodeled and upgraded some, that it will actually give it a better appearance. So that's just kind of an overview quickly of what's going to be done to the courthouse. When is this going to start? Again, if you look at Exhibit B, it does give you a list there of the dates when construction will begin. We're looking at least the initial round of projects coming back to the board on August the 3rd for the board to approve three things. You'll be approving the construction contracts, be approving the loan proposal from the lender, and then approving for us to submit the LGC application. The way this has to happen is, and this is because of the, this is according to the LGC rules, local government commission, is we have to bid out the project so we know exactly what they're going to cost. Then once we bid them out, then we send out the proposals to the bank because we know how much we need to borrow. Once the proposal comes back in from the bank, then we have to get your approval, and then at that point we can submit the application to the LGC, and so then we'll submit it at that point. Once we get approval, we anticipate that most of the projects in Group A will be able to send out, at least start construction, or send out notices to proceed probably around September the 11th. The other projects, the other half of them, will start sometime again after January the 15th. As I mentioned earlier, we do have money in our current budget, in our upcoming budget, to take care of the projects as we have them laid out. Of course, the year following that is when we would have the full payment in our budget. Next year, we have a budget about $250,000, I think $250,000 for next year's debt payment. The year after, we anticipate a full payment will probably be around $900,000 in that next year's budget. So,
on what term?
What we're looking at is we'll get quotes for 10, 15, and 20 years. The 15 years is the one that's about $900,000, so at 15 years. But we'll be getting proposals for 10, 15, and 20 and let you all decide as to which one you'd like to choose.
Have we explored all angles about renewing some of the bonds that bond indebtedness that we have that has some equity in it, too?
We have not. I'm not – that may be – and we have not done anything along those lines at this point. We have not.
Okay, because I brought that up before. It's my understanding that if your bond indebtedness is at a certain level, that you can renew those bonds up to 60% or 70% of the original or something like that without going to, you know, without having to put it to a vote and so forth.
Right.
And that
we could check on that.
I wish you would, because if it is possible, it would keep you from having to have a debt service of another $900,000, because that's a penny on a tax rate almost.
That's correct. Yeah, three quarters, somewhere in that area. But we'll check into there. One issue I do want to show you, there has been some desire. A couple of commissioners have mentioned the possibility of using the remodeled old courtroom up there as a commissioner's meeting room and to actually have our meetings there instead of having them in here. The seating capacity of that one, notice today, been rated by the fire marshal, well, not by the fire marshal, but probably by the city of Graham, was 221 occupants. So based on the lower level and the balcony, you can seat a lot more people than we can seat both here and in our overflow room. What we're proposing to do and what we've talked to the architects about doing, and this is a view of the old courtroom from the balcony. This is a witness stand, and this is a court reporter. This is actually going to be remodeled. This all will actually be the witness stand here. This is the clerk of court space here. What we're looking at doing is, this is the original bench, so this will not, it will be probably refurbished but not replaced. Is that correct? These areas will actually be replaced because these are not original. What we're looking at doing is actually the plaintiff and defendant's tables here. These are actually going to be replaced with tables that actually have a front and sides on them, I believe, that actually have coasters on the bottom. What we'll actually do is when we have our board meetings, we'll take these and rotate these around so that they face the public, both of these, and then we'll have a center section that you add into it. That's where y'all would actually sit. We'll bring in two additional tables, which will be seated here for county attorney, county manager, county clerk, and finance officer that will actually sit here. The podium will be moved back out to this area here, so when the public comes up, they would actually speak from here. It will not interfere at all with what's going on with the court, because what will happen is our staff will come in and set this up prior to y'all's meeting. Once the meeting's over with, it'll all be taken down and put back like it was. So it should not interfere at all with what the court's going on, what's going on in the court. Also, this will give us the opportunity to use this space at nights for other types of events that we may need a large space for that will hold more than what any of our other facilities will hold as far as for a public meeting. So that we wanted to kind of gauge your interest in that being renovated to use it for a commissioner's meeting room, because if we were to use that, it would need to probably become the permanent meeting space, because the cameras that are in this location and all of the equipment would need to be moved up there and permanently located up there. And we wanted to gauge your interest in moving forward and designing it with that in mind.
That's the best news I've heard all night.
I know it. I like it.
So I would gather then y'all are interested in that.
Yep.
The second part of that is that if we were to relocate the commissioner's meetings up there, what we could do is take this one and remodel it for the court system for a small courtroom. And one of the options, and we haven't really sat down and talked to the architects about this, but one of the options is actually being able to have by putting a hallway in, having the public actually enter the courtroom from that area, which would help with security and all of those type things. So those are some things that we're looking at. Just want to gauge your feel on that and see if that's something that y'all would have.
Sounds great to me.
Yeah.
Tim's not here, but we're
fine. I want to go back to another issue I talked about earlier. The windows replacement, this is where I want the architects to kind of get involved here.
Can I ask you a question before that?
Yes, ma'am.
I noticed there's nothing on here about Pleasant Grove. Is that because they don't really know what they want to do with that at this point?
That is not part of the facility improvement plan. The Pleasant Grove is not. Now, that's not. That's just not part of this.
Because I know we had talked about it at one point.
Now, they are working.
Making it a part of it.
Well, they are working on that, but that's a separate contract, and that's a separate project. Now, whether or not some of the funds from this would be available to help out with that, that would be an issue for the board to decide.
Okay.
So, at that time.
Because I know that the insurance is not covering very much. And I was at the meeting, and I know that we talked about maybe not refurbishing other than the gymnasium and maybe right. trying to find something else. But that's the reason I wanted to know about that, too, right. to make sure.
And it could be made part of this if we need to, or if we borrow the money, we could borrow the money for the improvements. And that's some decisions y'all have
exactly,
to make when they come
exactly,
back to
yeah.
about
I just,
that.
You know, I knew we had kind of discussed that at one point before. I thought we did about taking some of it.
Over.
And that'd be the pleasure of the board. Yes, sir.
On these bids, are we receiving bids from local contractors?
Hasn't been bid out yet. Those okay. will actually, I can tell you.
So these are all estimates.
Those are all estimates, that's correct. The yeah. bids will, bear with me just a second here. The bids have to, and they haven't bid these out yet. That's what they're working on now. The architects okay. is all the design work and the bid packages. They'll have to be back in around the first week or so of July for these projects that we hope to begin construction on September the 11th.
And we hope they're going to be a whole lot lower than all this.
There's a possibility. Some of the other local governments that have bid out projects have been getting favorable bids back in that have been lower than the estimates. So we hope this is a worst-case scenario, but we won't know until we get the bids back in. Those contracts will then be brought back to y'all for y'all to approve. So we haven't bid out. The only thing we've been doing, of course, the generator was bid out, a generator project, and the service will be. But other than this other stuff, there were some things that we had to get, like some asbestos. I think we may have had early on had some asbestos testing. There's some other maybe small things that we had to get done, but
okay.
but for the most part, no, this stuff has not been bid out. Okay. If we've done any work, it's been very small stuff, I think.
Could I ask a question?
Yes, ma'am.
Isn't the court room, the court building on the historical register?
That would be for them to address. Those are the two things. One is the historical issues that they're going to address, and then also the window issues. And if I can kind of give a little prelude into what they're going to talk about.
Yeah, I heard about changes and update yeah. and everything, and I didn't want to take away from that.
Y'all can't. One of the issues is the windows. We've looked at refurbishing the windows in there, all of the windows, and we've looked at the issue of replacing all of them. We think the most prudent thing is to replace the windows. They'll explain why. And then they'll also talk about the historical approval that will need to be given in order to proceed with the project. So, y'all.
Thank you, Tim. Well, my name is Lucian Routon. The state of the windows is such that if we can either leave them as is, and we don't know, and some of them, the sashes have been removed where there are air conditioning units have put in. Actually, a less expensive first cost option is to replace them with similar looking aluminum thermally insulated windows that have thermal breaks in the frames themselves. The difference between using that's our recommendation. There are two committees, and we'll get back into that in a minute, but there are two commissions, the Alamance Historic Commission. We've met with them once, and they had two questions. One, if you replace the windows, is there any benefit from energy cost savings? And two, would it preclude them from any future designation that they might get that could keep them from getting some sort of grant?
That would come from the federal government.
That could come from the federal government. Our first take on that from the state preservation officer, Mitch Wiles, is that no, it won't. And frankly, there's been some other things where some cornice work has been changed from the original to GFRC. It's a sort of a synthetic material hollow. He's going to confirm that, but his first take is that, no, that won't be an issue. Now, from the energy point of view, we had a energy comparison as it is now using the historical data that we've got compared to replacing all the windows with what, and even the least type of window we could use, would yield a 57% per year savings in the cost of energy for that building, both heating and cooling. So it is, and then besides that, the windows, like I said, will cost less to replace them with the aluminum that resemble, they're in the same profile as the existing windows. And there'll be a lot less maintenance cost over the long term. So that's our recommendation. In terms of where we are with those two, with the approval of the Alamance Historic Commission, we're in the process of getting back to them. We just got the data today about the energy, so we should have something back from them. If they approve it, they'll send it to you for a certificate of approval, and at that point we can move on. Now, the Graham Historic Commission, we've sent them a five-copy submittal each. We'll be meeting with them on May 12th at 5 o'clock, and I think it's going to be the same kind of thing. I mean, unless they have some strong objection to replacing this, we've done this in a building that Charles did that was on the historic register in Raleigh. The it's called the Old Health Building, about almost a beautiful old building just two blocks down from the Capitol. We did this very same thing, mm-hmm. Replaced the windows with, we left the frame in, and you put an aluminum pan, they call it a pan, but it's just a similar looking aluminum frame, same kind of profile, and then new sashes. So you get better operation of the windows with these windows. Now, so in that case, that's sort of where we are, Tim. But,
yeah, we just wanted to bring, because that will be an issue, I'm sure, for some as to why to replace versus repair the ones. We did get one window that was repaired, and we had the guy take it out and to repair it to see what it would look like and how well it would fit back in there. Didn't fit extremely well. Those are single-pane windows that are in there. The ones that will be replaced with will be double-pane windows, so as you mentioned, from the installation standpoint. So.
Okay.
So that's kind of where we are with that. Okay. Did want to talk a little bit about the courthouse. That project is scheduled sometime after first of the year. We will have to shut down the whole building during that process. We will be moving the clerk of court's office out. We're looking for rental space as we speak now. We're in the process of trying to find some space. So they'll be out probably 10 to 12 months, probably. That building will be shut down. So we'll have some logistics that we got to take care of as far as relocating them, relocating the Superior Court and all of that. So we'll be working on that.
Okay. Any questions?
On the ramps outside, how are you proposing getting them?
We've got a ramp proposed on the northeast quadrant. You go out, you go down to the right end of the porch, and you step off on a little, not a bridge, but it's a link that takes you out, and then it turns right, goes down towards the east, and then comes back, and it's... I think it's a very sympathetic design to the building, and I think it'll have minimum impact on that. It's a slim chance we won't need to do it if the same gentleman, Mitch Wiles, deems that it would harm the integrity of the building. In that case, the Department of Insurance would relent on their requiring us to do this because, in their mind, it's a tremendous safety issue. Right now, if anybody's in the courthouse in a wheelchair, they're in case of a fire and everybody rushing out of the building, they're going to be at somewhat of a disadvantage, and with the ramp they would not be. A public building, I think we might recommend that you do it anyway. I mean, it's an expensive proposition, but it would certainly, and actually for people wanting to come up who could use a walker and come into the courthouse without wanting to go down and go up the elevator to come in and pay a bill or something, they could use that. So that's where we're on that, Mr. Boswell.
And no objections from the historical?
Not yet. Not from the local. Either one of the local have not objected to that.
And the rendering that y'all did looks, it kind of ties in well, the ramp does. Y'all have done
right.
From an appearance standpoint, I don't think it takes away. It's not like putting a wooden ramp out there. I mean, this is something that's made of similar material to what the building
similar
is,
material,
and it
right.
fits in well.
So. Don't you have an office in Graham now?
It's just right down the street.
Okay. Can I get your phone number, please? Your phone number?
Phone number is 506-7414.
7414?
Yes, sir.
Okay, somebody's been calling me about something about the project, and I want to have them call you if you don't mind.
That's fine. 336.
They have a nice place there. Any more questions? Well, thank you so much for coming.
Thank you, y'all. Tim. Appreciate it.
I would like to introduce the director of the Family Justice Center, Deanna Manning. If you please stand up, Ms. Deanna. This is going to be the director of the new Family Justice Center. Okay? So this is Deanna Manning. If you got any problems, just give her a call. Okay.
Thank you for talking.
Thank you, Tim. Okay, and the next thing we'll... I can't say that. At this time, we're going to let Mr. Honeycutt come up. And in case you people have not met Mr. Honeycutt, this is your new county manager. And we're glad to have Mr. Honeycutt. We have really acclimated him to everything we got right now. We've been to Raleigh, and he liked to kill. No, I'm kidding.
I'm working on my driving.
Thank
so
you, sir.
I promise
they wouldn't
that.
Let me drive because they knew how bad. Thank you.
This is Betty Teddy over here, okay?
We won't even go there.
But again, thank you, Madam Chairman and Board of Commissioners for this opportunity. Amy is passing you out right now the manager's recommended budget for Alamance County. Again, this is recommended, and this is working with staff and working with department heads. And right now, we can change anything that we have a consensus on the board to change before the public hearing. So please fully understand that this is a recommendation, but we're here to do the wishes of this board. So that being said, we'll get to the bottom line. The overall review, our current tax rate right now is 58 cents per 100 evaluation. The revenue neutral tax rate is 52.35. Originally, we told you it was 52.15. However, with appeals coming in from the reappraisals, the appeals have gone down some, so that has caused the revenue neutral rate to increase. But we are still looking at a revenue tax or a tax rate of 52 cents, which is right at a little bit below revenue neutral. Major provisions of the budget. Again, the total budget is recommended is almost $150 million with a general fund budget of $131,886,522. Again, the amended 08-09 general fund budget is $133 million. So it's about $2 million less than the amended budget is this year. Fund balance appropriated for 2008-09 was $2.2 million. This year, we are recommending that fund balance be appropriated at $2.76 million. Part of this, what we are requesting to be used, and this will be a joint resolution with the school system, is use of the school ADM funds of $1.7 million from their fund balance. We can request this when there is a decrease in sales tax and Article 44 funding, which there definitely is. So we're asking that that be used this year. Overview of agency funding, looking at our two largest agencies. The Alamance Burlington Schools is at $35.27 million. And again, even in this economy, that's a 2.8% increase over the 08-09 recommended or approved budget. And the community college, Alamance Community College, is $2.95 million. Which is a 3% increase over the 08-09 fiscal year budget. Major additions to the proposed funding. As Tim mentioned earlier, we have debt service that will be required for the $10 million in capital projects. This year for the 09-10, the debt service will be $275,000 as projected. And the reason for that is the lateness of the project and the lateness of getting
everything bid out. So we'll only have really one quarter that we'll have to pay for in this year's budget. The big thing we need to be sure of and make sure we're aware of is that at 10 and 11, debt service is projected to be at $900,000. So for the 10-11 budget, we'll have to come up with $625,000 worth of new revenue to fund the debt service. So I wanted to make you fully aware of that. Again, we do have some additional debt service this year on the 800 megahertz project for CECOM. The $678,722. And then also, the board has a commitment and an option right now to purchase the old school property in Graham for $500,000. So that comes out of our fund balance as well. And that's part of the reason why fund balance has gone to 2.7. Major cutbacks to the proposed budget. Again, if we look at our sales tax, we're projecting sales tax to decrease by 18.1%, and that's a decrease of $4.7 million. We are not recommending in this budget an increase to the teacher supplement. Again, that is something I applaud the school board. I applaud this board of trying to get to the 10%. But in this year's budget, staff, we just cannot recommend it this year, but it would remain at 8%. With that being said, we are not projecting a cost of living for county employees this year. Originally, I think we talked about the budget retreat to look at a 2% increase. We even talked to Dodge ways of even looking at that as January 1 and doing it for half a year. But in looking at debt service and looking at our fund balance, we felt uncomfortable about recommending that at this time. But we are looking at recommending 5 bonus days for county employees to be used between July 1 and June 3rd. New positions. As the board is aware, we currently have 15 frozen positions. We have looked at it, and we're recommending that 11 of those positions be funded in next year's budget. So we are cutting out 4 positions at this point. One of the positions that was requested was in inspections and, or excuse me, in planning to do some of our nuisance abatement issues. We worked with Bob and Jason to kind of have that as a shared position. Bob and inspections will go out and do the inspections for the nuisance abatement. Jason's office will take care of the paperwork. So we're going to try that and see how that'll work. Both Jason and Bob have been very open to this, and I appreciate them working with us and trying to get this taken care of. There's a dental assistant that's being recommended. We do have 8 positions that are looking at being reclassified, and that's due to career ladders, having increased certification or increase in education. So there are changes there. And there's one new position recommended in Parks and Recreation. That's a trail and open space coordinator. Really, that's just changing the title. Currently, he is on staff as a contract position. We are doing that as a shared position with the city of Burlington and Graham. We also are getting part of a grant to fund that. But to make that a full-time county position will be an additional $14,000. So not a large increase on that. Again, we talked about capital projects. We have the $10 million worth of new debt service for the capital projects, and we looked at vehicles. We've tried to put our vehicles very strategically, 7 for the Sheriff's Department, 1 for the Fire Marshal's Office, and for EMS, we're looking at replacing the chassis on an older vehicle. I think it has over 200,000 miles. One of the big issues that came up with respect to this board during the budget retreat was our travel policy. And we're going to look at some of the recommended changes. We have requested that, you know, from that retreat, we cut 10% across the board from the original request on travel. Travel in-state would be approved by department heads. It would not have to go back in front of the county manager, but if it is in their budget, they could approve travel within state, registration and even overnight in-state. We are also recommending that we reduce our per diem from $45 to $30 daily. And also, also with that, if registration or breakfasts are included as part of travel, we're going to back that out as well. So you just don't get the $30 regardless. You know, if meals are included with the registration, we're backing that out as well. Again, one of the big issues I think the board had was no out-of-state travel. If required, we have no out-of-state travel in our current budget. But if it is required, the department head will make a presentation to the Board of Commissioners for approval. The Sheriff's Department, however, does have $10,000 set aside to pick up felonies. That would not require board approval. You know, that is something they have to do on an ongoing basis as far as felony pickup. But out-of-state travel that is also fully funded by grants would be approved. So we're just trying to make sure that no county dollars are going to out-of-state travel unless approved by this board. What's next? Set a public hearing for May 18th at our board's regular meeting. The question is, do we need a change in location? If we project a lot of people to be here, we can go to the old courthouse. We can try to get that set up, but if the board so chose, we can try that. But again, after the public hearing, we can approve at any time. If there's additional workshops that are required after you receive the input, but any time before, after the public hearing and before June 30th, we would need to approve the budget. Again, I want to thank Tim and Amy and the finance department, and department heads. This is the start of my fourth week. They did an absolute wonderful job to get us to this point. And all the help that they have given me, I really do appreciate. And any questions?
Was that open for questions?
Not yet.
But also,
on the sheriff's cars, did he? We not decide he had money for those cars?
We originally cut that to four cars, but in working with the sheriff, we found some additional funding within inside his budget to.
So part of this is coming from.
Part of that is coming from him as well.
Okay, because yes, that's what I wanted to find out about. Because I knew that we had talked about him using his drug money or recovery money that he had for the cars.
Money.
Okay.
Drug forfeiture money.
Okay. I just wanted to ask that.
But he's not here.
But I do also want to say that a copy of this proposed budget will be on our website as of 3 a.m. tomorrow morning. So we will, for those who want to look at it, make comments, but by 3 a.m. tomorrow, I've been told it will be on the website.
What will our fund balance, what's the estimate on our fund balance after we
tap in? I think it'll be around 12.5.
It's around 13 now. So, you know, if we had to use the full 2.7, it'd be down some. If.
Right.
Hopefully we won't have to.
What does that bring us down to percentage-wise?
About 10%.
About 10.
Yeah, it's about 10%.
By state law, we have to maintain what's about $9 million, isn't it?
For
Eight percent.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Any questions?
It's only good shape.
All right. Yes, not. Thank you. Good job. Okay. The next thing is the consent agenda. Does anybody have any questions on
that? Oh, I do have a couple other things.
I saw that, the discussion of the agenda communication.
This was a request at our last meeting about how we as a county can get out the agendas more readily. We currently have one citizen that has signed up and pays an annual $10 cost for our Sunshine List. Mm-hmm. We would encourage our citizens to sign up for that, and we will mail them copies of the agenda. The $10 just covers postage, but we also mail copies of the agenda to all the media outlets. We also put our agendas and agenda packets on the website by Thursday before the meeting. Other than purchasing ads and setting aside, you know, that area for agendas, I don't know anywhere else that we can get out the information unless the board has any suggestions. We can't think of anything else, but again, we would encourage citizens if they're interested to get on that sunshine list and would be happy to mail it to them.
Well, and they can come by and pick one up.
Yes, ma'am.
At will.
Yes, ma'am. And I do have one other thing. These things have kind of come up today in discussion with our county attorney. We have a couple of issues I'd like for him to talk about. One is the county line issue with Orange County, and the other is an update on the Jordan Lake rules.
But before I do that, we need to set a date for the public hearing on the budget.
Yes, we do.
Yeah. Okay. We have a date that they've asked for, May the 18th. Do I hear a motion? We accept the May the 18th?
I'll make that motion.
Second.
Okay. We'll make it in a second. All in favor? Okay. No opposed.
All right. Thank you. On the let me start with the county line issue. And Bruce Walker and I went to meet with our counterparts in Orange County last week. And we discussed the county line issue and where we stand. You know, they have two new board members there, and they are going to do some training with their board to discuss the issues on the county line.
Can I ask you to wait till we get to announcements on that, since that's not part
sure
of
it? That's fine.
Do you mind?
Yeah. It's consent agenda. You're getting ready to get it.
Yeah. If you don't mind, if you,
no mind.
You wait till the announcements. Okay. I'm sorry. Yeah. Because I'm already on the consent agenda.
Okay.
At this point. So, does anybody have anything to pull on that one?
I'd yes. like for to pull out 11G and 11E, the two resolutions.
Okay. And E.
Yeah.
Okay. E and G.
Yeah, 11G resolution opposing the transfer of state secondary road program counties. I mean, I couldn't. Of course, I'm going to support that. But yeah. Who introduced that?
I don't.
Senate Bill 758. Do you have any idea who introduced that?
I've got it right here.
I bet there's no R beside his name.
Senate Bill 758 was introduced by Senators Rucho and Clodfelter.
Okay, I've heard of Clodfelter.
Yeah. He's the Senate, he's the chair.
Democrats, technically.
I don't know.
Yeah, Clodfelter. Unaffiliated.
We've never maintained the roads, have we?
No, we have not.
We never have. And no. And they're trying to balance the state budget on the backs of the counties again.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
Again.
And there is some. There's another effect of this too. The Jordan Lake rules passed. The county will be the proud owner of the water quality ditches on each side of these roads.
Okay. And same question on 11E. If you can explain 11E and who introduced that, H.
That bill is
House Bill 1252.
Yes, I think I've got it here.
Okay, the Senate version is 104, and I guess the House version is
the level playing field. Act.
Yeah.
That was Senate Bill 1004. Or House Bill 1252, introduced by Senators Hoyle and Clary. And what they're seeking to do is prevent local government from engaging in the communication business, providing communication services to the public.
I read them, but I
didn't know. I'm not going to fib to you. It's in lay terms. Okay. I mean, you're recommending, staff's recommending that we support. I'm well, going to support this one.
Again, this bill is also related to the first one, Senate Bill 758, because if we own the right-of-way, then we control who's in our right-of-way. And I think that's probably an unintended consequence of this bill, but they are related in that regard. Because if we do own the right-of-way, then we'll have the right to charge license fees to people that are in our right-of-way. I don't think anyone in Raleigh thought of that. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Can that off?
Yeah.
Ms. Vaughn would like to pull.
L, please. Regular meeting of April 6th. You had me down as giving the. Uh,
convocation. Remember, we had Pastor Don Sweeney here that did a wonderful job of holding a service and also giving a prayer, so I do want to credit him with that. Don Sweeney on a regular meeting of April 6th.
Oh.
Pastor Don Sweeney.
Not day before.
No, that was in the morning.
Oh, okay.
The regular meeting. Go to the next page.
Oh, that one. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. We checked all that. Anything else? Any more questions on the consent agenda? If not, do I hear a motion?
Move.
Make it through. All
right.
Second, on favor.
All right.
No opposed. Okay. Now we'll start with the commissioner's comments. Eddie. Ann. We don't have any commissioner's comments. We'll go, now we'll go to announcements.
Oh,
okay. And I'm sorry.
That's all right.
I'm trying to go by this agenda now.
Mr. Walker and I went, and we have been trying for a year now. Bruce, you can stand for your
phone. Yeah, Bruce.
We've been trying for 2 years now to get together with Orange County, with Guilford County on this county line issue. Orange has added two more commissioners to their board, and they have decided they would rather do a training session with the geodetic survey folks on a two commissioner at a time basis rather than have a joint training with this board, which is what Bruce and I originally suggested, which is all fine and good. And they are going to consider all the things that I'm going to ask this board to consider in a training session. I'm going to suggest that we have our own training session with this board and with the geodetic survey folks, Gary Thompson and Dennis Lee, who have experience in these county line issues, and discuss all of the issues surrounding the location of and mapping of the county line, from the issue of schools to EMS to fire protection, sheriff services, election issues, and those type of things, and liability issues. And I would suggest that maybe we get the clerk to get together with the five of you and pick a day where we can have maybe an hour or two or more to really get our arms around this issue, because a 20-minute spot at a meeting like this meeting, it really doesn't give you the time to engage in the question and answers that you do, that you'll have the opportunity to engage with Gary and Dennis, who have experience with other county line issues. So that's the first thing we're going to talk about.
Okay.
Setting up a meeting like that. I would suggest that it be a public hearing where the public can observe, but not, no question and answers from the public, but they can observe the board interacting with the folks from the geodetic survey. The second issue is the Jordan Lake rules. We got a late email late last week that the from the Piedmont Triad Council of Governments, indicating that a proposed committee substitute had made its way to the environmental Committee of Environment and Natural Resources. And the proposed committee substitute makes Alamance County a critical watershed. The effect of that may be to require 2 to 4 acres for a house, per house. We don't know exactly if that's going to be the effect, because the rules aren't gelled yet. They haven't finalized what the actual rules are going to be. But the proposed legislation would require existing development to comply with these rules through an adequate management approach, or an adaptive management approach, which is sort of vaguely described in this bill. The problem that I have with it, and that the planning director, and I think most of the people I've talked to about it, Bob Ward, city attorney in Burlington, have with, there are no clear rules. There's no model that's been developed yet. Yet Alamance County is going to be required to comply with these rules and to map the county and enforce them. And there's really no way that I know how we can do that. So it's going to be heard tomorrow in Raleigh. And if it survives the committee, it will go forward to the crossover to the Senate on Thursday, May 14th. If it doesn't make the crossover, it dies in the House. And I have given the packet to Senator Vaughn, and he is going to deliver it to Senator Forrest for their review. But it was a little surprising to me that we had taken the position that we were against the rules, and now we come up with a compromise that I don't think is going to benefit Alamance County. So I wanted to report that to you tonight.
Any questions? Any other announcements?
You have one.
I just had one, Craig. I think I misspoke during my presentation. The generator project for this building, that was actually approved or not 2 weeks ago, so I think I misspoke earlier.
Okay.
Okay,
so do we need to vote on that?
No, y'all actually.
We already done it.
And that was actually Caterpillar Local, wasn't that?
Yeah.
I read
okay.
that.
I do have one announcement, if nobody else has any. I did swear in the Board of Equalization today, and we had two gentlemen from Raleigh with the state Department of Revenue, Mr. Harris and Mr. Brown, that came, and they gave a great preview today. I didn't know they were going to be here, but it was good. And there is a little booklet that we're going to all get one of that goes over all the rules and regulations that the board must follow, because we do have three new members on the board. And they went over this whole booklet today. It was very, very instructive for me to learn some of the stuff that I had no idea about it either. So I knew I was very appreciative that they were here. And actually, we were there from 2 o'clock till, what time? I forgot. It was after 4 o'clock when we got through with them, because he went over the booklet pretty close to everything in it. So this new board now has been instructed as to what they can do, what they cannot do, how the people have to respond. One thing I didn't know, that if you send somebody else in for you, that you have to give them power of attorney to come in to act on your behalf, and that was something that I had no idea that you had to do that. So you cannot send anybody in to speak on your behalf of your reevaluation with the BOE. So that was done today, so everybody can now appeal to the BOE after they get their papers, which Ms. Horton, and she is here, I'm pretty sure, that they will come out sometime in late May, by the end of May anyway, the last, anyway. That's the latest thing on that. So just wanted everybody to know that. And Carol Oakley is going to provide us with a booklet like the board has, the BOE has, okay? Any more questions? And that all? Okay. We are adjourned.
Thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur at 7 p.m. on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building located at 124 West Street in Graham. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioner's website at www.alamance-nc.gov.